Controlling surface texture is key in order to ensure proper performance of mechanical components. It is not enough to accurately specify dimensions of mechanical components to obtain correct function and performance. It is necessary to consider its surface finish. For example, the surface of a cam on a camshaft pushes the tail of the valve at high speed to ensure fuel intake and gas evacuation, synchronously with ignition. Long-term reliability of this element depends on its roughness, that leads to friction, and could result in premature wear. But it also depends on the presence or lack of waviness, which can cause vibrations and heating. The surface of a cylinder bore must have crossed grooves to allow sufficient lubrication of the moving piston, to avoid engine tightening. But these grooves must not be too deep, or they may potentially increase compression losses or lead to excessive consumption in fuel and oil. The cylinder head gasket ensures sealing both by its form and its chemical composition, but also by its surface texture, and by the surface texture of the opposite sides which are in contact with the cylinder head and the engine block. Injectors are crucial parts that ensure the performance of the engine and its ability to meet modern emission standards. Most internal surfaces around of the injection nozzle are specified precisely in surface texture. The pinions of a gearbox are specified in roughness and waviness, to ensure their performance in the greatest silence for driver and passenger's comfort. Many other components of a vehicle also have their surface texture specified and controlled. The grained plastic of the dashboard, the connector contacts of wiring harnesses, the metal inserts and the buttons of the dashboard, the car body at different stages of preparation such as cataphoresis, primer, and the different layers of paint and varnish. Outside the mechanical and automotive industry, many objects of everyday life are also controlled for functional reasons or aspect. The metal shell of a smartphone must have a soft touch that ensures a good grip, but should not to be marked with fingerprints. It should not get dirty too easily and must also offer a luxurious look. Its surface texture is controlled by many complex specifications. The front glass protects the screen, but it is also a tactile area which must accurately respond to the fingers of the user. Grained plastic of a laptop case or of the keyboard keys provide comfort of touch and effectiveness in operation. Connectors must ensure good electrical contact and sufficient clamping during insertion and withdrawal. One could multiply examples endlessly. All these products and manufactured objects we use every day are controlled by the industries from their design to their production, to ensure that they provide the desired function with maximum efficiency. The function of a surface corresponds to the designer's intent. A component should adhere to another. Or on the contrary, ensure lubrication when sliding on another surface. Or, enable effective tightening. The designer of the part specifies dimensions but also its surface texture to ensure that the function will be realized correctly during manufacturing. Many parts today are manufactured by subcontractors, often in distant countries, and accurate specifications reconcile requirements that should be respected. This is called functional specification, defined in GPS standards of geometric product specifications and verifications. These specifications are given on drawings. They must then be verified to assess compliance of the component. Regarding surface texture, the ISO 13002 standard describes a visual specifications language that designers must use on mechanical drawings. An indication of surface texture is done through the root symbol, associated with indications that provide the parameters to be controlled and their limits. Indications of surface texture are part of the tolerancing of a workpiece, as are indications of size and position. This standard will soon be replaced by ISO 21920-1. The metrologist responsible for verifying a workpiece on a production line will sample some parts to measure them. He or she will rely on specifications written on the drawing and will use a profilometer or any other suitable means to measure profiles, or sometimes surfaces, and then calculate the surface texture parameters that are specified, to finally compare their value to the tolerance limits. When checking surface texture of a workpiece, a measurement is made at a location indicated on the drawing, generally a limited portion considered as representative of the surface to check. For example, a profile is measured on a portion of a drive shaft. What is measured, materialized by the profile, is actually composed of several surface texture components that are treated differently in surface texture analysis. The nominal form is the geometric shape of workpiece. This is usually a straight line in the case of a flat part or a circular arc in the case of a cylindrical part, superimposed on the surface texture. This nominal form is deleted by calculation, since we are interested here only by surface texture, not geometric dimensions. The form deviation is due to inaccuracies in the production of the theoretical form during machining. A workpiece that is supposed to be cylindrical is in fact slightly oval because of, for example, the biasing of the tool axis. This form deviation is also removed by filtration. The waviness and roughness are the main components of surface texture, and these components are the main objects of tolerances in surface texture specifications. Waviness is made of longer wavelength components than roughness. They are separated in practice using a filter which can be adjusted by a cutoff lambda c that depends on the application. Roughness is the most important for almost all functions. Each machining process leaves a signature on the surface which results in specific roughness and oriented grooves. Waviness is important especially when surfaces are in contact with each other, for clamping functions, sealing or sliding. Micro roughness contains the smallest wavelengths. It comes mostly from instrumental or environmental noise. In most applications, this micro roughness is removed by a low-pass filtering. We see here how the elements of finer texture find themselves in the roughness and the longest in the waviness. This separation concerns lateral wavelengths in the horizontal plane, not the amplitude of the texture. The sum of waviness and roughness is the primary surface or the primary profile. It is possible to tolerance one or the other of these components with roughness, waviness, or primary parameters. For example, a parameter RQ will be calculated on the roughness profile, WT parameter will be calculated on the waviness profile. The mechanical part is first imagined by the designer on his CAD software. On the drawing, he adds dimensional tolerances and surface texture tolerances. But before getting a profile on which the metrologist can calculate parameters, he must go through a conceptual stage which involves the theoretical profile on which tolerances are applied. The nominal profile is the theoretical profile, mentally constructed by the designer using a partition operation on the geometrical part. The partition is realized here by taking an intersection plane vertically through the volume of the workpiece and isolating the workpiece top, resulting in a rectilinear profile. This profile is then qualified with a surface texture specification, for example using the parameter RQ and the upper limit of 0.7 microns. The nominal profile is a theoretical profile imagined on the drawing. This is generally a line or an arc or in more complex cases a spline shape. The reality on the workpiece is unknown to the user, because one can only produce an abstraction of reality. The user can only know what goes out from the measuring instrument. Nowadays, it is a digital representation, sampled along x, in successive points, spaced by a constant spacing delta x expressed in micrometers, and digitized in z, using integers, spaced by the value of a digit delta z expressed in nanometers. In the case of a 3D measurement using an optical profilometer, an image of heights is obtained where z is a function of x and y. It is common to represent the data using an anamorphosis, which amplifies the z-axis much more strongly than the x-axis, to better see changes in heights. In reality, the surface is almost flat and drawing the profile to scale would show us only a straight line without details. Valleys and peaks visible on a profile are therefore greatly exaggerated compared to reality. In the case of a surface, it is also amplified on the z-axis, but heights are also encoded using a color palette that separate the local variations of height. Again, changes in the topography are greatly amplified, and a surface drawn to scale would appear completely flat and smooth. Finally, a question asked by many users, should we measure the surface in 2D or 3D? Should we calculate parameters on a profile measured along a straight line, or on a surface measured on a rectangular portion? If surface texture metrology has long been exclusively profilometric, it is partly because of technological limitations of measuring instruments, but also because industrial surfaces were then simple enough to be reliably analyzed in 2D. But over the last 20 years, this is less true, and we can say that we are witnessing a paradigm shift in three parts. Firstly, surface texture measuring instruments evolved from profiles to surfaces. Nature is three-dimensional and some functions can be analyzed more reliably using surface parameters. It is said that one gets better functional correlations. Secondly, technology moved from contact to optical. This allows faster measurements and makes it possible to measure fragile materials without damaging them. Thirdly, industrial surfaces nowadays are often structured or textured to imprint a special texture that performs the desired function. For example, hydrophobic surfaces are often equipped with microscale geometrical structures such as pillars or pyramids to prevent droplets from adhering. They require new analysis tools and require aerial measurements. These three reasons explain why surface metrology has changed so much in recent years and that new analytical tools and new measuring instruments have appeared. Discover more videos and resources on our surface metrology guide, or visit www.digitalsurf.com.